The Spirit just touched me as we were singing, and I just cannot help but say, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good, that's what you were just singing, that I've tasted that the Lord is good. I'm not sure everybody, in fact, has tasted that the Lord is good. And that's kind of the end point where we want to get to. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good, then like newborn infants, long for pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow into the fullness of salvation. That, by the way, is 1 Peter 2 and 3. Great stuff. I want to begin by words matter. Words matter greatly. And we twist words and we take words. So I've got a really, what's the difference? What's the difference between a golfer and a skydiver? Wait for it. Here goes. A golfer goes, whack, shoot. And a skydiver goes, shoot, whack. Sorry, that's pretty bad, eh? Wait for it. That's the lighter note for today. But it's serious because words matter. Words take us to all sorts of places. What I want to do is my spirit over the last while, you know, we've had Remembrance Day and very formal services and all sorts of very important things. But I, in my spiritual life, I'm saying, Lord, what is it that you want to do here? What is it you want to do to let the Spirit release here at St. John's? And I'm struck at one of the things that we say all the time. Glory to God. It's on their screen. It's a little light. You may not be able to see it. It's from Ephesians 3. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. We say that every week. It's what's called as a doxology. That's kind of church language. Not everybody knows what a doxology is. Doxa is a Greek grounded word. Doxa means glory. So glory to God. We give glory to God for everything. And so at the end of a service, ultimately for all that we do, we want to give glory to God. So it's a doxology, and church is always do. Glory to God, whose power. And we do that. I worry that we say it almost by rote. Do we know where it comes from? And so today I want to begin by having you turn to Ephesians chapter 3 in your pew Bible and follow along with me. I have purposely not put the words on the screen. That's the page number in your Bible. And you will follow and learn much, much more if you actually open your text. There are pew Bibles, and I encourage you to open it. Otherwise, listen intently. I read from Ephesians chapter 3. I'm going to highlight some passages of Scripture because I think it's important that we're grounded in the Bible. There's some stuff that goes on before we get to verse 14 where I really want to get into. But I am going to highlight verse 2 and 3, God's grace that was given to me and how the mystery was made known to me by revelation. So this is St. Paul. He's writing to the church of Ephesus. It could be St. John's. And he's saying, what I'm sharing with you came from God. I didn't make this up. It's by revelation. That may be offensive to some of you. Because what do you know? How do you know he didn't dream it? On what rational grounds? But the church is based on revelation. Verse 5, in former generations, this mystery was not made known to humankind as it was now being revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. So what he's saying is that this news of Jesus, which is a revelation to the whole world, that the Old Testament, they only had glimmers of it. They didn't have a full understanding of it. And I, Paul, have received this full revelation, and now I want to share it with you. So I jump to verse 14. It's because of this reason of what I've just shared with you. I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. So that's pretty radical. He's calling God Father. There's an intimacy implied in this text. Verse 16, I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you, so he cares about you, may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his spirit. Wow, do I want us to grab and hang on that? That you be strengthened in your inner being. So here's part of the problem. It's not a problem, it's part of a reality, is that spirituality is generally, it's hard to discern it on the outside. It's an inside work. And so some of you come to church and we all polish up and brush our hair and make sure we're looking good and we present our stuff. The real question is, what's going on in your inner being? So this is an inside job. This is what God's doing. And he's going to grab a hold of us, every one of us, and turn us and shape us and mold us, reveal to us. And then there's an outward being. I think that the church spends a lot of time on outward signs. Not all wrong, because outward signs point to inner realities. But as I talk today, and I talk about revivals and all sorts of outer things, I want you to land on the inner being. God wants to strengthen your inner being. How many of you feel weak in the course of a week? W-E-A-K, in the course of a W-E-E-K. How do you often feel weak, E-A-K, because your inner being just doesn't feel strong enough? There we are. And that's the inside work. That's why we come to church. That's why we worship. That's why we get centered. So when we ask the question, what's the best day of your week? What's the best point? You gave all sorts of answers. Almost everybody who talked to the vicar said Sunday morning. That was the correct answer, by the way. Verse 17, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. So there's a riddle here. It's by faith. As you are being rooted and grounded in love. Now I want you to look for the word power here. It keeps coming up. I, verse 18, pray that you may have power to comprehend. So the text is saying here, without God's power, you ain't going to get this. And that's, again, offensive to our natural way. I want this all explained to me. It's got to make sense. When it makes sense to me, then I'll respond. I want us to move beyond that intellectual place. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints. And he's short of words here so far, the breadth and the length and the height and the depth. And to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. So this, again, is huge. This is such a rich text. It surpasses knowledge. Now, one of the things I'm going to get to before this day's out is I'm going to be talking about things that surpass your intellect. And I'm going to pick on some of the greatest intellects in the history of the world to show you that what we're talking about transcends intellect. I'm not saying we forget our intellect. I was talking to Guy. You know Guy, our new staff member. He's down at St. Leonard's preaching right now. He's down there with Tim, okay? But I was talking to Tim and to Guy, and we had this conversation. He said something, I paraphrase it. He goes, we say it every week. It's infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Are you really prepared for something to happen to you that is beyond your imagination? Really? I like my control. Let's be honest. But because I like my control is why I have difficulty, and you may have difficulty with your inner being. When you surrender that, I'm not saying park your brain, but there's a majesty, there's a riddle here, there's the Holy Spirit. You can't put the Holy Spirit in a box. You can't possess it. Because it's a he, a she, it's the Spirit of God. Know the Christ that surpasses knowledge so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Do you want to be filled with the fullness of God? How many of you want to really be filled with the fullness of God? Really? Those of you who, okay, that's good, because there are days when I don't want to put up my hand, okay? And I'm your vicar. And the thing is, the reason I don't is because it scares me. Because when God really gets a hold of our lives, he really changes stuff. And if that gets let loose here, oh my goodness, watch out, Toronto. Okay? So now we get to this punchline that we say every week, verse 20. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or even imagine, to him be glory, doxa, gloria. In the church, so it happens in the church, whether you like it or not. I don't like church. I like spirituality. How many of you heard that one? Sorry, but the text says that this church is actually a central part of God's plan. So when I get to heaven, I will talk to God about that. I'm going to say, could you have not have done something different than church? Because there's so many problems with church, but it's the Spirit of God working in us, doing infinitely more through the church and in Christ Jesus from generation to generation, through all generations, forever and ever. Amen. I hope you're seeing how radical this text is that we say every week. It surpasses understanding. At foundational level, it is the power given to us that produces faith. Faith is a gift. Faith is something, as I said 2 weeks ago in a sermon, I said, what's the one thing that wowed Jesus? You answered, faith. And you're right. What wows Jesus is our faith. And what wows Jesus also is our lack of faith. He's mind-boggled at our inability to get it. He says, what don't you get? And what happens is if you go to verse 12 in this text, I've lost my bookmark. Verse 12 talks about a confidence. How about that? In whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. And so this Christianity, when you enter into that spirit realm, it's not a lack of humility. There's a humility because you know you're dealing with God. But it creates in you a boldness. And I know people who sit at the back of church on purpose because they don't want to sit up front because I'm not feeling bold. Not everybody, but I'm just some, you know. There's that piece. Certainly none of you at the back. But okay. But the piece is that We say in our prayer book, and he is bold to say, our Father who art in heaven. Isn't that kind of an odd thing to stand before God with boldness? What I'm saying to you is that when you need to mark this, do you have a boldness? Because if you do have a boldness, it may be a sign that the Spirit truly is working. That all of a sudden there are days when I go, who am I to stand up here? Who am I to stand up here and talk about this book? It's crazy. And yet there can be this quiet confidence that Christ gives us because I know that this word is faithful. So I put these things to you so that they may shape your new life. So possession is likely the wrong word. But to the point of conversion or awakening, there is a point of conversion in your life. An awakening in your life where you experience this in your inner being instead of things being helter-skelter. After the election last week, oh my goodness, the election last week. Okay, go Trump, go, right? I mean, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to say. And there's a mixed house here, you know, of where we are. I was struck at how words could not define how everybody was feeling. Do you know what I'm saying? Facebook was just riddled with stuff. I mean, it was just almost too entertaining. I had to turn it off at one point. So I think of words, 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 words. And there's so many words. And I go, that's why we sing, you know? That's why we do music. Because music transcends stuff sometimes and takes me places that the preacher will never take me. And God knows, and amen. Amen, sister. Said the lead in the choir. There we are. Okay, I get that. Okay, but there is There's me. So I'm listening to all the vitriol and how confused everybody felt. And this artist brother of mine posted a Picasso, and that's what he put on. And he says, "This is how I feel. It's, I sort of understand, but I don't understand." You see, here is how art transcends words. What I want you to grab with this is that Holy Spirit transcends words. Holy Spirit transcends your categories of knowledge. And yet we are called to be knowledgeable. So I hold that to you. I see this as a metaphor for what can happen to any of us when the Spirit gets a hold of us. When this revival happens in your inner being, as individuals, well, you will get a scene that might feel like this on your internal being. And that's one of the reasons we love Picasso. But there's a lot of people who don't like Picasso because it's just not linear enough for me. And yet we all know he's a great. And because he transcends. So what I'm talking about is a revival that can happen in your hearts, that I pray, God, that a revival could let loose here, because I see the work of the Spirit among you. And I want to talk about what that really looks like. Revivals have happened all throughout history, from the ancient church right up to today. So I want you to know that there was a revival that hit Ontario, Toronto, in the early 1990s. It was called the Airport Vineyard Ministry. Put up your hand if you don't have heard anything about it. Now put up your hand if you've never heard about it at all. Okay. So there's a lot of you who haven't heard about it. Touched hundreds of thousands of people throughout Toronto, but I would suggest the world. It happened at the airport where they set up hangars, a church service, and the manifestation of the Spirit of God was palpable. Guy Chevreau, who's one of our new pastors, he's down at St. Leonard's, as I said, has written about it. It's called Catch the Fire in the 1990s. And this is what he wrote. And he cites some incredible things that went on there. He was one of the pastors there. There was manifestations of the Spirit that would have bothered many of us Anglicans. There were manifestations of the Spirit of such healings that people did not know what to do with it. The Archbishop of Canterbury, however, did give it his imprimatur and said, "This is okay." At which time I went to the Airport Vineyard to visit with a group full of clergy, and boy, did I get my socks blown off. I didn't know I was going to do it, but I'm going to do it because it's here. I go and I visit on a Wednesday afternoon, and they have only clergy there because it's an invite for clergy to convince guys like me to try to do and let the Spirit go in our local congregations. Because quite frankly, in most of our congregations, a lot of us are what we call Anglicans chosen, frozen, right? Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of my glory. I mean, we have to be contained. I go to this event, and they have carpet time where they have prayer time, and people are healed, falling on the floor, people are laughing, all sorts of stuff. This is so not my cup of tea. I go sit in the back in the corner, and I start reading my Bible. I come up with three passages of Scripture. I still remember those three passages of Scripture while people are having their prayer time. I just quietly pray, because that's what I do. I still even remember the text. Doesn't matter what they are. It's John 14, Acts 1, and Luke 3. Those were my three texts. That's fine. I go to an evening service. 4 hours later, we went out for dinner with a group of us. We went back to the worship service. It was a Wednesday night. It was a mere, 5,000 people. And they were flying in their airplanes from all over the world, get touched by the Spirit, and back they go. There's a story for you. You should listen to their stories. Preacher comes up. And he says, I'm not going to preach tonight, but I got three texts I just want to quickly share. The first one is Acts 1, then John 14, and Luke 3. Those were the three texts. What are the chances of that? It was much more dramatic than I've just communicated. I could really milk that one, and I'm not going to. God works in powerful ways. There was a revival that transformed and shaped the entire East Coast of the United States. Secular historians study it. It's called the Great Awakening. And the man who led that charge, arguably, was one old-looking dude named Jonathan Edwards. 1703 to 1758. He was one of the smartest men I've ever read. He dies in 1958 taking a smallpox vaccination. He's the principal of Princeton University at the time, and he dies. He has had such an effect. This revival happens throughout the East Coast of the United States, and guess where it starts? It starts in Northampton, it starts in Connecticut, it starts in Massachusetts, it starts in, of all places, Yale. He's a Yale man. Won't hold that against him, but he's a Yale man. He's a thoughtful, intellectual man. They say in the recording of the history that the revival started in the academic community, among the professors, because they needed credibility. Or that's my answer for why it did. God just chose to do it there. These are very thoughtful men that shaped the world. There are books written about it. You can get a précis of that in Guy's book about what are the hallmarks of a great awakening. So today I'm going to give you quickly some points that you need to mark. I would like these discussed in your small groups, whether you're doing good and beautiful or not, doesn't matter. Just I'm asking. You don't have to, but you can. Your bulletin says five marks with five little dashes. Take some notes, write them down. This is what Jonathan Edwards says are the pivotal signs that a revival is let loose in your community. But guess what? It has to happen in every individual. The five signs of revival, and I'm going to your inner being here. Before it happens outwardly, it's going to happen in every individual here. And if you resist it, then it will be resisted. So the release of the Spirit almost is an act of faith by you. We can debate that, but I think there's some truth in it. Here's what happens when the power of God, that's that Ephesians 3 thing I was reading to you earlier, that transcends understanding, when that power lets loose in your life, here's something that happens. Here's the first hallmark of a sign of revival, awakening, conversion in your life. Number one, a love of Jesus. All of a sudden, you cannot get enough of Jesus. If you are having difficulty, there have been times in my ministry when I've said, you know what? Whenever I talk about Jesus, I sense people get uncomfortable. Whole lot easier if I just talk about God. Right? Just talk about God. It's safer. There's a little more distance. But Jesus. Who is this Jesus? And what happens is that you get a hold of the truth that this Jesus really is set apart. That the church is right. He's second person of the Trinity. That's why you don't take the name of the Lord thy God. You don't say JC in vain. You don't do that because he's so dear in your heart. No one needs to legislate that with me. It's in my heart, the love of Jesus. When your children ask you, where's God? What's your answer? Jesus is the full revelation of God in space and time. There's your intellectual answer for that Picasso picture of spirituality. It's about Jesus. Number two, we renounce worldly passions, lusts, and ambitions. These are taken from Jonathan Edwards. We can debate them. This is what he experienced in the 1730s and 1740s in the East Coast of the United States. That all of a sudden, the carnal ways of the world really do become offensive. And they start to drop away from you. It doesn't mean you don't slip or fall from time to time, because maybe you've been disconnected. And that's why we have to be connected all the time. If you think I'm making this up and this sounds too puritanical for you, I would point out that when we do a baptism, I'm pointing to the font over in the corner, not to any parishioner over there, we do a font, okay? On page 154 of the Book of Alternative Services, we ask the candidates, when we're baptizing them, and we ask them, will you renounce the ways of the world and the evil things that draw us from God? That's point two. It's in our prayer book. It's in our tradition. But what I'm saying is, this is in your inner being. The third thing that happens is the love of Scripture. Now that you have tasted that the Lord is good, do you crave spiritual matters? And if you do, you will find you cannot get enough of the Bible. You will start to say, the Spirit starts speaking there. If you find that you don't really care about Scripture, then you need to ask yourself, where's the spiritual awakening in my inner being? I'm not judging anybody. I'm just saying to you that that's what happens. You hunger for the Word of God. That doesn't mean you don't wrestle with it or tear with it. But that's one of the hallmark signs, is the role of Scripture. Why does, in the Anglican Church, when you come to church, we read more Scripture than any denomination I know. We just go on and on and on. We read Scripture, we chant Psalms. We're always in the Scripture because it's understood that this is where the Spirit of God is released. God's Word will not come back to me empty, says the prophet Isaiah. So that's the number three. Number four, says Edwards, is the love for a hunger for the Spirit of truth. What happens is all of a sudden you start to hear non-truth in a way that you didn't hear before. You can filter things. All of a sudden, now you can get in trouble there. We can get right, self-righteous, and that's one of the reasons for the community is so important. But it is a sign, folks. Do you hunger for truth? Truth and love, they come together, and I guess that would be number five. The hallmark is true Christian love of others and a kindness. And I quote 1 Corinthians 13, all of a sudden that text really becomes real to you. I mean, if you hear 1 Corinthians 13 and you start nodding off, you've got to look at yourself and say, what's going on? I mean, it's such a... love is kind, love is gentle, love, you know, it does not hold grudges. It's one of the most powerful texts. It's a sign that the Spirit of God is having a revival inside you. And that's where I want you to go. We will come and become, as the sermon title is, a peculiar people. So what I want you to do is own those 5 points. What's the fifth point? Christian love of others, a kindness. That all of a sudden, there is a love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, long-suffering within you that you did not experience before. I ask you to take those 5 points, go home and think about them and say, are these happening in my life? Do they transcend my imagination and my categories? We become a peculiar people. We just had a huge election south of the border that's had a huge impact on us. And I know I don't want to get into politics. I want to get into spirituality and faith that transcends all that politics. In our Good and Beautiful series, Community, book number 3 that we will get to, I have to steal something out of it. It's so good. And it's about becoming a peculiar people. If these 5 signs are within you, you will become a peculiar people. This revival happened in the ancient church, not just at the Airport Vineyard, not just in the East Coast of the United States in the 1700s and 1800s, but in the ancient church. This is what was written about 150 AD. People were spreading false rumors about Christians, saying that we were a dangerous, secret society filled with bizarre behavior. You don't look like you're very bizarre to me. I hope not. We were practicing cannibalism, the body and blood of Christ, right? So there were concerns about us, and this non-Christian writes this. The difference between Christians and the rest of mankind is not a matter of nationality or language or customs. Christians do not live in separate cities of their own, speak any special dialect, nor practice any eccentric way of life. They pass their lives in whatever township, Greek or foreign, each man's lot has determined. And they conform to ordinary local usage in their clothing and their diet and other habits. Nevertheless, the organization of their community does exhibit some features that are remarkable, even surprising. For instance, though they are residents at home in their own countries, their behavior there is more like transients. Though destiny has placed them here in the flesh, they do not live after the flesh. Their days are passed on earth, but their citizenship is above in the heavens. They obey prescribed laws, but in their own private lives, they transcend the laws. Do you transcend the laws? They show love to all people, or all men as it was written here. All men persecute them. They are misunderstood and condemned, yet by suffering death they are quickened into life. They are poor, yet making many rich, lacking all things, yet having all things in abundance. They repay curses with blessings and abuse with courtesy. For the good they do, they suffer stripes or whippings as evildoers. Does the church today sound like that? It's one of the greatest deterrents for church growth is that we don't live by that standard. I pray, God, that we will live by that standard. I do ask you, those of you who have been troubled by what has gone on south of the border, to watch your tongue. Let us be civil. Let us be kind. Let's pray for those we don't agree with, that this country and this nation of Canada, the United States, and Europe be a civil place. To this end, I ask that the power of God does work in your life. So I wrap up with this. I am blown away, in a very positive way, of the stories that come into my office of how the power of God is working in your lives, infinitely more than some of you could ever ask or imagine. I walked in my office the other day, there was a check, $250, I think, sitting on my desk, and there was a note, just said, "Boy, was there a prayer answer to my life last week. I don't know what to do but to say thank you. Thank you, God. I want to show something." You need to share your stories. It is not a mistake that at the beginning of church we get you talking about pickles or the weather or what's your favorite thing. You need to learn how to speak to one another. That we can actually end up getting to a point where we start talking about actually profound things of where the power of God is working in our lives. Because it will be an encouragement to the person sitting next to you. When I was 24 and converted in church, in a brethren church at the time, and they broke bread, and when they had communion, so I'd go to church at 10:30. There was, I don't know, 750,000 people. It was a huge church. But at 9 o'clock, there was 100, 150 of the devout who said, "We are Christians and we break bread. That's what we do." Because those 5 points had hit them. So it had happened to me. I had now tasted that the Lord is good. And I remember sitting. You know what's unique about the brethren? The clergy don't stand up and preach at that service. They have an altar, they have a table, they have bread and wine, and to consecrate that bread and wine before they take it, members of the congregation just stand and share their stories of where the cross of Jesus Christ has changed them in the course of the week. I guarantee you, I have to tell you something. There I was, a mere 24 years old, quietly hiding somewhere back there or there or wherever. And the last thing I would ever do is stand up and speak. Oh, no. But I had these elders of the church stand up. And all of a sudden you stand up and you share with everybody in about 3 minutes what God had done in your life and why you were coming on your knees to that holy table. The impact on me, sitting back there quietly, was infinitely more than I can ask or imagine. I need to hear your stories. I want to share your stories. I think that it might be a little scary for us to be doing what I'm just suggesting there. We are Anglican after all. We're not going there. We don't do those things. So what I ask is, if you have a story, you give it to me. You can give it to Ann. Give it to Tim. Give us the story of what God has done in your life just in the last week. It could be a simple little thing, but what an encouragement if we were able to share some of those stories from week to week. We call them testimonies, but I don't want to talk about Drew. I just want to talk about what the glory of God, what is God doing in the life of the community, and watch where it happens. For God will do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. From generation to generation in the church, and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.